The Torah tells us, Leviticus 18, God spoke to Moses saying, speak to the children of Israel and say to them, I am Hashem, your God. Do not perform the practice of the land of Egypt, which in which you dwell, etc. And then there is a list of arayot, list of forbidden relationships, which we read several times a year, particularly on Yom Kippur afternoon, the Day of Atonement. Some of them is a prohibition against any type of relation within the family. One of them, it's in line 14, verse 14, the nakedness of your father's brother you shall not uncover. Do not approach his wife, she is your aunt. The subject we're going to talk today, it's back to Yevamot, but also we're going to speak about mixture of children. Those who have the opportunity to read a literature of the Shoah, of the Holocaust during World War II, the reality is that people were hiding sometimes for a long time in the hidden places. So I'm just using it as an example. The discussion here is a situation of a mixture between babies, so between children, while the whole manor was in a state of unknown because it was in a dark situation. But that's just part of that. We are on page 99, the top of the page, Tanu Rabbanan. Yesh choletz le'imo misafek, ve'ye la'achoto misafek, levito misafek. Here, Rabbi Akiva Iger tells us there is a concept called Sfek Sfeika, meaning we have a quandary within the quandary. The idea is there is a case which, in which one perform a chalitza, which is the manner of release, with his mother due to a uncertainty, or with his sister due to uncertainty. And Rashi explained to us that when we read the original Mishnah on page 2, you see on the list sister from his mother as one of the list of 15 arayot, 15 forbidden relations that exempt the co-wife from chalitza and ibum. So this brayta come to teach us that even though there are situations a person need to perform chalitza to his relative, because of safek, because it's a state of uncertainty, such as mother, sister, daughter. Keitzad, give me an example that that taken effect. Imo ve'isha acheret ve'lahen shnei zcharim. Yes, his mother and another woman, they have two sons. וחזרו וילדו שני זכרים במחווה. And as we said, it can happen that with the darkness, dark situation, it was again rebirth of two baby boy, while one of them it's clear and the other it's not. Meaning, just using names, Rachel, the wife of Jacob, Rashi said, she brought, excuse me, the son, Joseph. Hana, the wife of Reuven, give birth Chetzron. So you see here, then she have the second one, the baby mixture while they were born, and we are not sure who is what. You see in the Gemara Chevrusa, in some of your Gemaras, the charts, right? You see some charts in your Gemaras?
Chevrusa, 99A1.
Yeah. So they give you some chart of, very nice, with colors, that's not Gilbert. Anyway, Uvabna Shelzo, after the passing of the husbands, the son of the first one, married ונשא אמו של זה. He married the mother of the other one, ובנה של זו, and the son, the first son of the second one, נשא אמו של זה, which means the clear son of each of them married the other. Again, after Jacob and Reuven passed, Yosef, the son of Jacob and Rachel, married Hannah, and Chetzron, the son of Reuven and Hannah, married Rachel. Umetu belobanim, even each of them has a son from different men, it's not exempting the other from Yibum, because the husband who passed did not left any sons. So it means that each one of these two women fell to Yibum before the second husband's, the brother of the second husband, which is one of the son of the mixture. When Yosef and Chetzron passed away, the wives, which is Hannah and Rachel, fell before the brothers, which is Rachel, the wife of Chetzron, before the brother, the son of Hannah, and Hannah, the wife of Yosef, before the brother, the son of Rachel. So, meaning Rashi said that these two mixture in a state of darkness over there. And as a result, since we are not sure which one is the brother of the husband and which one is the son, meaning the whole concept of noldu b'mechveh, that they are born while they are hiding, it creates two sfekot, two quandaries. We are not sure who is need to do yibum, a levirate marriage, and therefore misafek, because you are not sure, you need to do zeh choletz lishneihen vezeh choletz lishteihen, which is in a way he does chalitza to his mother. Nimtza, consequently, what you see from here, kol echad ve'echad choletz le'imo misafek, each one of them needs to do chalitza to his mother because of that safek, of that uncertainty. So the Braita continue, la'achoto misafek keitzad, when a man need to perform chalitza with his sister due to uncertainty, give me a case, give me an example. Imo ve'isha acheret she'yaldu shtei nekevot b'machaveh. As I use that World War II, because that's close to our time, people are hiding in different location, which can be very dark place for a long time. I think I told you, when I was a rabbi in New Jersey, we have a congregant, may she rest in peace, whose name is Raz. I don't want to give the last name, but anyway, she used to take the Rebbetzin to her house. She used to have a big house, and she took her to her basement. And I remember at that time, Miriam was petrified, because in her basement it was a sugar, eggs, oil, shirts, all kind of things. But most of those stuff were rotten, worn out, not befitting by any means.
Past the use-by date.
Totally, past the use-by date. Mm-hmm. So Miriam said to her, Raz, why you need it? And she hold her hands and she says, in tears, you have no idea. She says, we are hiding for years from the Nazis. Mm-hmm. So I wake up at the middle of the night, it's dark in the house, I'm scared. I go to a basement, I turn on the light, I see all this food. Excuse me, and it give me comfort. Mm-hmm. It's like psychologically give me comfort. Even all that food is rotten, staying there for years. It's hard for us to comprehend, but if you visit the Holocaust Museum down in DC, you comprehend a little better what happened to our people. So it is a reality that can be that, like we said here, that a mother and another wife have two baby girl in the hidden place, in the mixture between the two, and each of these women has a son from a previous marriage, meaning each of the sons, this son have a brother from the mother, that to one of the sisters that mixed between. In other words, it's all, in a sense, crisis, but it's unpredictable crisis that we just need to face reality and handle it as is. Uvau achehen shelo meotahem. So now the brothers of the two sons, meaning the brothers from the father only, not from the mother, unesa'u, they marry the two daughters that what? That mix. Meaning, for example, each one of the daughters has a son from the previous marriage. So in our language it's like a stepson. Reuven and the father of Reuven have a son from different wife. Meaning that the brothers of Reuven, that it's only brother from their father, and the sister of Reuven, that she is only sister from the mother, they are not relatives to each other at all. The same applies to the mother of their second daughter. They have a son from a previous marriage. His name is Chetzron, and his father has another son from a different marriage. Meaning that the brothers of Chetzron and the sister of Chetzron also are not relative to each other. Two brothers from the father of Reuven and Chetzron went ahead and married the daughters that was mixed, that actually they are not relatives of them. That's the way Rashi explained in the second scenario. You see it in in Yu Gemoras, the Chevrusa, I think the other Gemoras, the Sochotchov, they give you a chart, right? Anyway, so the Gemara explained, Umetu, the husband passed, Belo Banim, meaning they have issue of Yibum because there is no children to perpetuate the soul. Meaning, here the burden or the mitzvah of perform a Levirate marriage applies to the brother from the father, to each of them. He choletz lishtehem, which means each of them does chalitza to the widow of the brother who passed, because in that circumstance we know who is the brother, and consequently she is exempt in either way. If she is a sister from the mother, she doesn't need chalitza at all because she's erva. And if she is the daughter of the other wife, he's already performed chalitza. So it means that he's not that perform chalitza to the two yevamot, the both of them. The same way as we said earlier, when we have a quandary, who is the yevamot, each of them. But each of them does chalitza to one of them. So since this is a mixture of almanot, and we are not sure which one is the mother of each of them, and each of them carry this uncertainty, because maybe she's not a sister, and therefore, thank you, she needs chalitza. So each of them needs to do chalitza to the wife, the widow wife of the brother, because the state of uncertainty. That's basically the vignette of Rashi. Nimtza, as a result, choletz la'achoto misafek, that one performs chalitza with his half-sister due to uncertainty. Continue the bride. Levito misafek keitzad, when we speak about one who needs to perform chalitza with his daughter due to uncertainty, give me an example. Ishto, his wife, ve'isha acheret, there is another wife, שילדו שתי נקבות במחווה. As we said, that's basically a duplicate to the previous scenario. ובאו אחיהם, the brothers of the two husbands, ונשאום, they married the two daughters that were mixed, which means the wife of Reuven and the wife of the other one, let's call him Caleb. They have two baby girl, and they are not relative of Reuven and Caleb to each other, but the babies were mixed, meaning the brother of Reuven married the wife one of those babies, and vice versa, and the brother of Caleb married the other. Why? Because the daughter of the brother, he can, Rashi explained, he's permitted to do it. So now, u'metu belo banim, since they pass with no sons, therefore ze choletz levito misafek, one who need to perform chalitza with his daughter due to uncertainty, and the same the other, ze choletz, each of the fathers, which is Reuven and Caleb, needs to do chalitza to the widow of his brother, that it's one of the babies that would mix, even that it was safek bito, the uncertain daughter of the Avam, because if we know clearly that each of the brothers of Reuven and Caleb married the daughter of his brother, you do not need any chalitza, because then each of the widow, she was the daughter of the Yavam. But since in our case, each one of the widows had an uncertainty because she's maybe the daughter of the brother of that husband, so therefore each of them has which we call a claim of chalitza. That's Rashi used that term in Meiri too, the concept of choletz lebito misafek, because it's uncertainty, he need to perform chalitza to his daughter. Tanya ya Rabbi Meir Omer, now we're dealing with yichus, which means a lineage, issue of children that have a different lineage. Tanya ya Rabbi Meir Omer, ish ve'isha pe'amim shemolidim chamesh umot. It happens sometimes that you have a husband and wife, man and woman, that sometimes they have five separate categories of lineage. Ketzad, here is an example. Yisrael shelakach eved v'shifcha min hashuk, a fellow Jew that in those days acquired a servant and a maid servant from an idolater. He did not do the brit milah of the male. He didn't do the tvilah l'shem avdu. So they're still considering a Canaanite servant and maid servant. And therefore, as far as the mitzvot, we treated them in that way. Because as long as they're idolater, they don't have any mahut, any part of the those obligations. But velahen shte bani, meaning they have two sons that was born while she, the maid servant, was idolater. So the idea is venitgayer echad mehem, so one of the sons convert to Judaism. Nimtza, you see a result, echad ger ve'echad oved kochavim. You see, one is a convert as a Jew and one is an idolater. Hit bilam leshem avdut nizkeku leze laze, because the purpose was clearly for the serving. So in addition to that son, you have another two from the previous one. Harekan ger ve'oved kochavim, the first two, ve'eved שחררת השפחה, and the servant basically that he come from the baby of the maid servant Canaanite, he is basically a servant, and he by doing so release the שפחה, the maid servant, and she became regular Israelite. ובא עליה הבד, after she was released, the servant have relation with her. הרי כאן גר ועובד כוכבים ועבד וממזר. So it means you have all of that together, because the whole that if עבד who come and have relation with Israelit, the baby is illegitimate. שחרר שניהם, meaning he release also the servant, which means both of them consider Israel, והשיאן זה לזה, and they married each other, which is now they have the fifth son, הרי כאן גר, ועובד כוכבים ועבד וממזר בישראל. Now you see how we reach five. מהי כמשמלן, what we derive from that? עובד כוכבים ועבד, הבעל בית ישראל, אבל עד ממזר. Okay, because according to Rabbi Meir, the act of ממזרות, it's a baby that born by cohabitation of man and woman that doesn't have any תפיסת קידושין, doesn't have the notion of acceptance, matter of betrothed. And now, all those isurei erva, all those forbidden relations such as sister, daughter, etc., it's included, but also baby born from that relation, or a servant that come from that relation would. But so they said tanu rabanan yesh mocheret aviv leagbot imo ketubta. Unfortunately, sometimes there are people who need to pay the ketubah. So there is a case which is a man sells his father. In those days they used to sell people, right? In order to collect his mother's marriage contract for her. Ketzad, here is an example. Yisrael lakach eved b'shifcha min ha-shuk, which means he purchased them from idolater. And they dug themselves in a mikveh for the purpose of being a servant. Okay? Velahem ben v'shicher et ha-shifcha, which is they have a son, not the son of the Israel, and he released the maid servant, unsa'a, and then he married her, ve'amad ve'katav kol nechasav levna, and then he wrote, after he released her, all the property to the son, which is son, servant, and maid servant, and it's all idolater. And then when he passed, the person who married her, and she come to collect the value of the ketubah, of the marriage contract, from that nechasim meshu'abadim, nimtza, as a result, ze mocheret aviv, leagbot le'imo ketubta, which means that he sell his father's in order to receive a mother, collective for his mother, contract, the ketubah. My kamashmelan, what we derive from this teaching? Kula Rabbi Meir, the entire brighter follow-up Meir, which is ve'avda metaltelei u'metaltelei mishta'abdei lichtubah, which is that the servant is considered as a movable property, and there are those who hold that movable property cannot be mortgaged. And so it's not so simple. Tosfot basically tells us that the whole idea of Rabbi Meir disputed the concept of servant is the same eved kekarka. He said is the issue. Why? Because he said one is come to movable property, metaltelim. People can move it, can take it, can hide it, can cheat it. People don't trust this type of things. Versus karka, e movable object. So this is something that people trust. Take for example servant. He can run away. He can pass away, right? So here, the Tosfot said, only in this manner, Eved kemetaltelei, we treated a slave the same as a movable object, and this manner, metaltelim mishta'abedin liktuba. Ve'i ba'i te'ima, there is another option to say, the legal status of a slave הקמשמלן עבדה כמקרקע דמי. That it's the same as real estate. The slave is the same as real estate. And therefore, according to everyone, one is obligated to sell his slave to pay the marriage contract. Now, the Mishnah dealing, which we mentioned earlier, in Leviticus 18, verse 14, there is a discussion what happened with the mixture. Ha'isha shenitarev vlada bivlad kalata. Woman that whose offspring was mixed with offspring of her daughter-in-law. So here you have the issue that's b'machve, that it happens in hidden places. It's not in a hospital. Hospital usually it doesn't happen, right? Now, since you don't know who is the son, who is the grandson, so you have igdilu atarovot. The mixed sons mature, venasu nashim vametu, and the married woman, and they die without children. So basically, those two women, they are obligated to have yibum or chalitza. One, the son of the daughter-in-law, and one, the son of the old lady. But since we don't know who the husband was the son of the daughter-in-law, and who is the son of the old lady, both of them, because of that uncertainty, needs to have chalitza or yibum from the brothers of both of them. In order to be sure that we don't have any more state of uncertainty, Bnei Hakala, those sons of the bride, that meaning that the one who know with no doubt, the Mephoshim said that's not necessarily Bnei, it can be one individual, the same rules apply. So the Cholzim Belom Yabmin, they need to do Chalitza, but not Yibum. Why? Shehu Sfek Eshet Achi, Sfek Eshet Achi Aviv. Because it is uncertain whether she is a brother's wife, and therefore his yavam are uncertain whether she is his father's brother's wife, who is forbidden to him. So, because of that, sfek eshet achim, sfek eshet achi aviv. So the Mishnah says, "Bnei hazkena," the older woman, the sons of the mother-in-law, cholzim velo biyamim. They must do chalitza, but or levirate marriage. But the other one said, "Shesfek eshet achiv veeshet ben achiv," because it can be yachol yot shemetu achim vadaim. It may be that the clear brothers passed, or maybe sfekot, some that they have uncertainty. Metu hakshirim, if the Kohanim's offspring, which was originally not clear, but now they passed away, and it's not any quandary who was the mother of those hata'arovot, those mixture, meaning the sons that mixture with those widows, livnei azkena, which is the widows, cholzin velo biyamin, shehu sfek eshet achiv veeshet achi imo, because it's uncertain if she is the brother's wife or father's brother's wife. And then they said, "Eshet achiv." Said, "Belibnei akalach, echad choletz veechad miyaben." When it's come to chalitza, this dolo, so one choletz, one miyaben, which is the big chiddush, because even if she is in his father's son's wife, she's permitted to him. And then kohenet shenitarvev vlada bevlada shivchada. That's another situation. You have day. One the Kohanim family, the female, that the offspring or mixture together with her maid servants, which is total different status. So they said, and we don't know who is the son of the maidservant, who is the son of the wife of the Kohen. So you have a Safek Kohen, Safek Eved. So therefore, הרי אלו אוכלים בתרומה, both of them can eat from the תרומה, וחולקים חלק אחד בגורן, and they shared a תרומה in the granary. 99b, ואינן מתמאים למתים, since each of them is ספק כהן. It's a question if he is yes or not כהן. So in the sense, the Torah prohibited a כהן, a priest, to be contaminated with ritual impurity to a corpse. That's famous statement in Leviticus 21. And therefore, even someone is a ספק כהן, it's not clear that he's a כהן, he cannot contaminate with that, because we have a concept that it's called ספק דאורייתא לחומרא, something that it's biblical, we treat it with stringency. ואינן נושאים נשים, when they grow up they do not marry other women, בין כשרות בין פסולות, regardless if they are כשרות, because it's a question if they are servants, or if, because they are ספק כהנים, they are disqualified. הגדילו התערובות ושחררו את זה, זה את זה, which means if the father of the Kohen who is deceased passed, and the son of the Kohen inherited that servant, and it's not clear who is the Kohen and who is the servant, and those sons grew up, the Kohen and the servant, and each of them gave the other a shtar shichrur, a release contract, in order for the servant for sure will be released, and therefore they are both will be released, meaning the Israel and the Kohen. So they said, נושאים נשים ארעויות לכהונה. Since one of them is a Kohen, so after its release, the servant become ger, and he can marry a Bat Israel. That's the Rambam said in Ilchot Isurei Biyah, chapter 12. Because we, in our circumstance, one of them is a Kohen, and we are not sure who is he, both of them are prohibited to married women who is prohibited to them, like grusha, a divorcee, and chalutza. Next. Ve'enam metam'in lemeitim, the same reason, they not become ritually impure to the corpse. ואם ניטמאו, if they contaminated from the dead, אינן סופגין הארבעים, since each of them is a ספק כהן, so therefore they don't receive the מלכות, because you don't give a מלכות for something that it's not clear. ואינן אוכלים בתרומה, because it's uncertain, they cannot partake of eating truma, because it may turn that one who eats is a servant that was released, that he is now considering a zar, someone from outside, that prohibited to eat truma. ואם אכלו, if they eat truma unintentionally, אינן משלמין קרן וחומש, they are not obligated to pay, which the Torah said in Leviticus 22 verse 14, they do not obligated to pay the principal plus one-fifth. That's the obligation of someone who's zar, who eat truma. ואינן חולקין על הגורן, meaning since the one who's released is Israel, so when you divided the truma, you do not do that from the goren. So it's a discussion, Tosfot challenge here the what the Rashi said, because he said if both of them come together and they want to partake the part of one of them that he is a Kohen, so you don't give them because the concern is that they may come to eat it. And then we said umochrin et ha-truma, which is they do not need to give the truma to the Kohen because they cannot eat it, so they sell it to the Kohen, but v'hadamim shelahem, because even the Kohen has to bring a truma from his field. So therefore, the Rambam said in Ilchot Maaser, the first chapter, that he doesn't have the obligation to give it to another Kohen. So therefore, since the both of them needs to separate a tithe from their field, because it's considering Torah, Advadai, so the one can say, Hamutzi mechavero alav arayat, you have to prove that I am not a Kohen, and if you prove I'm not a Kohen, then you can have this truma. So because we have this rule that anytime you have a claim, you have the burden of proof. So Rashi explains, they have to sell all these, the produce, and they have to sell it to the Kohanim, because each of them is considering a safek zar, and therefore, all the money belongs to them. Ve'inan cholkin bekodshei hamikdash. So here, we talk about the share of consecrated offering in a temple. So that's divided between the Kohanim. Even some of the Ola offering, or other kodshei kodashim, that was given to a Kohanim, because each of them it's only Safek Kohen, so therefore the question if that person had the right of the part of that Orot, so you cannot divide it because it carries his Kedusha, his sanctity, by manner of we have to be very careful when we disperse something that carry that sanctity. He said, "Ve'ein notnim lahem kodashim." You don't give them the firstborn of animal or other charamim that you give to Kohanim. "Ve'ein motzihim shelahem mideim." You don't take any if they have each of them the firstborn by himself. You don't take those consecrated item from them. "Upturim min hazroa umin al chayim umin hakeiva." They are exempt from giving the Kohen the foreleg and front giving of the jaw, and from giving him the maw of their non-consecrated kosher animals. It's all part of that a biblical obligation to give. Here they are exempt. That's the Torah said in the Deuteronomy 18, verse 3. But the Gemara in Chulin 131 said that the Kohanim exempt from that. Uvchoro yeheroe, because it's Sfek Kohanim, so they said the firstborn, the first of the kosher animals should graze until it become unfit, ad shiistaev. ונותנים עליו חומרי כהנים וחומרי ישראלים, and we place upon him both the stringencies of Kohanim and the chumron, the stringencies of Israelim. Later the Gemara in next page explain this halacha. Now the Gemara tells us, what do you do with those sons that you're not sure what this their status? Metu hakshirim Ela hanach, those unflawed lineage, mishum de'i aruv lehu, havu lehu psulin, because they mix during the process of pregnancy, they considering unfit, for sure not. So why the Tanakh call something that is clear, kasher? So amar av papa, eima umetu havadaim, So he said, and if certain sons were the ones who died, לבני הקלה, אחד חולץ וכו'. דווקא מחלץ והדר יבמוי. Specifically, if one does חליצה to that widow, and then he does יבום, אבל יבום בראשה, לא. Why? דקה פגע ביבמה לשוק. Because he's breached the prohibition against the יבמה engaging in cohabitation with a member of just לשוק of a public. כהנת שנתערב. So we said that if the ever כהנת whose offspring was mixed with her maid servant's offering, so the Gemara asks חלק אחד פשיטה. If we talk about one that received one share, so clear, it's not more. אימא חלק כאחד, which means one part, they receive a share at the granary only if they come together. תנן, כמאן דאמר אין חולקים תרומה לעבד אלא אם כן רבו אמו, דתניא. אין חולקים תרומה לעבד אלא אם כן רבו אמו. דברי רבי יוסי, דברי רבי יהודה. רבי יוסי אומר, יכול שיאמר אם כהן אני תנו לי בשביל עצמי, ואם עבד כהן אני תנו לי בשביל רבי. Which means he asks either way. If I am Kohen, give it for myself. And if I am a servant of Kohen, give me a truma for my master. So which means Rabbi Yossi allow to divided truma to a servant who come to pick up from a granary to his master. So he said, Bim komosh Rabbi Yudai umalim truma liyo chassin. Which means here it's different because they said in the Rabbi Yuda place they will elevate a person to such a presumptive status of kehuna for the purpose of lineage on the basis of having received truma. So if they saw a person receive truma, they will assume that he is a kohen and testified to the effect. So as a result, truma was not distributed to someone who might be a slave, unless he was accompanied by his master, lest the slave be assumed to be a Kohen himself. But he said, במקומו של רבי יוסי לא אמרים תרומה ליוחסין. In the place of רבי יוסי, they didn't elevate the person to that lineage. So therefore, he was allowed to receive תרומה independently. תניה, אמר רבי אלעזר בן הצדוק, מי אמר לו, ידעתי אלא עדות אחד ואלו עבד לכהונה על פי. Which means I gave a testimony to one of the lineage of a person because they see that I saw that they gave the granary part of that truma, and as a result they take my word and they did it. So although they presumptuously examined the matter carefully, it was a mistake. So the Helusa Kadatach, which means that they do it just by the witness of Rabbi Elazar ben Tzadok, Hashpa Behemtan Shel Tzadikim Min HaKadosh Baruch Hu Mevi Takala Al Yadam. It's a concept that we say that animal of the righteous Hashem does not bring about a stumbling block. So it's a famous story on Gemara Hilchulin, page 7, the donkey of Rabbi Pinchas Ben Yair, that donkey, listen to this, refused to eat for something that was not tight, meaning he gave him, Rabbi Pinchas Ben Yair gave him food, and that food was not tight, and the donkey refused to eat it. So again, that's, we can say, how do you say that, maybe it's a transmigration of soul, right? But the idea is that's animal, tzadikim atzmam lo kol shekin. If you tell me that this is what Hashem take care of those animals of righteous people that does not bring about a stumbling block, then the righteous themselves, all the more so, that it is not, that God does not bring about stumbling blocks. So Tosfot said, נראה דלא גרסין עלי, דלא שייך הכפירך אלא מקום שהרחם עצמו נכשל באכילה דסור ואין להאריך כאן. Okay, anyway, I wish to have more time, but this is interesting point, Tosfot said here. אלא אימא, ביקשו לעלות עבד לכהונה על פי. and eventually they didn't do it. Chaza be'atrei de Rabbi Yossi, ve'az said be'atrei de Rabbi Yehuda. So they said that Rabbi Elazar bar Tzadok saw a man receiving Truma in the place of Rabbi Yossi and testified in the place of Rabbi Yehuda. So since in the place of Rabbi Yehuda did not disperse Truma in the granary to those servants of Kohanim, so therefore that's the reason that they tried to elevate to Kohanah. Because Be'atro de Rabbi Yossi lo ma'alim liyuchasim, Be'atro de Rabbi Yehuda ma'alim liyuchasim, so you should not say it, but Hashem help anyway.
Shulaim, Malachai, Shulaim, Malachai.